Hello everyone, I am going to demonstrate you the general features and attachments of hip bone in three parts. In this part, I am going to demonstrate you the general features and attachment of ilium and also learn how to determine the side of the hip bone and how to hold it in anatomical position. The hip bone is also known as innominate or pelvic bone. It is an example of irregular bone in our body. The hip bone is formed by fusion of three bones. The upper expanded part is known as ilium. The antero-inferior thin part is known as the pubis. And the postero-inferior thick and strong part is known as ischium. The ilium, pubis and ischium, they fuse with each other at a cup-shaped cavity, which is known as acetabulum, so that the upper two-fifths of acetabulum is formed by ilium, antero-inferior one-fifth is formed by pubis, and postero-inferior two-fifths is formed by ischium. This is the acetabulum, which faces laterally downward and slightly forward in anatomical position. The inferior aspect of acetabulum has a gap which is known as acetabular notch. This notch is filled up by a ligament known as transverse acetabular ligament. The floor of the acetabulum is non-articular and rough, which is known as acetabular fossa, which is filled up with fat. Whereas this inverted U-shaped or horseshoe-shaped lunate articular surface is lined by hyaline cartilage and it articulates with the head of the femur to form the hip joint. The margin of the acetabulum gives attachment to a fibrocartilaginous structure which is known as acetabular labrum, and also to the capsular ligament of the hip joint. Below the acetabulum there is an opening which is known as obturator foramen. The obturator foramen is large and oval in males, whereas it is small and triangular in females. The margin of the obturator foramen gives attachment to obturator membrane, which fills the obturator foramen completely except in the region of the obturator groove. This is the obturator groove through which obturator nerve and vessels pass out of the pelvis and come on the medial compartment of the thigh. Coming to the general features of ilium, the upper end of the ilium, which is in the form of a rough ridge, is known as iliac crest. The anterior end of iliac crest is known as anterior superior iliac spine. Anterior superior iliac spine. The posterior end of the iliac crest is known as posterior superior iliac spine. Now this is anterior superior iliac spine. And to determine the side of the hip bone, we need to know one more prominence which is present on the pubis. This is the pubis. This is the body of pubis. This is the superior ramus. And this is the inferior ramus of pubis. Along the superior border of the body of pubis, there is pubic crest. This is pubic crest, which ends in a tubercle laterally, and that is known as pubic tubercle. The anterior superior iliac spine and the pubic tubercle lie in the same coronal plane. This is anterior superior iliac spine and this is pubic tubercle. Keep it in the same coronal plane in such a way that the posterior surface or the pelvic surface of body of pubis faces upwards and backwards, and the medial surface of the body of pubis lies in the median plane. So this is how you hold the hip bone in anatomical position. This is the left hip bone because the ilium, which is the upper expanded part, you keep it superiorly. The thin pubis anteroinferiorly. The thick and strong ischium posteroinferiorly, whereas acetabulum should be facing laterally downward and forward. On the posterior aspect, there is a deep notch, which is a greater sciatic notch. So keep the greater sciatic notch in the gap between your thumb and index finger of that side. So if it is the left hip bone, you keep the greater sciatic notch in the gap between your left thumb and index finger like this. So this is the left hip bone in anatomical position. Again, keep the anterior superior iliac spine and the pubic tubercle in the same coronal plane in such a way that the posterior surface of the body of pubis faces upwards and backwards. The medial surface of the body of pubis should be in the median plane. So this is the anatomical position of the left hip bone. This is the right hip bone in the anatomical position. And as we can see, where the two pubic bones meet in the median plane, this is known as pubic symphysis. About the iliac crest, which is a rough ridge on the upper end, as we can see anteroposteriorly, it is S-shaped curve and it has a long ventral segment and a short dorsal segment. If we see the ventral segment, it forms more than anterior 2/3 of iliac crest, whereas the dorsal segment forms less than posterior 1/3 of iliac crest. The ventral segment has an outer lip. This is the outer lip. This is the inner lip. And between the two is the intermediate area. As we can see here, from anterior to posterior, the anterior end is concave inwards and convex in the posterior part. Whereas if we see the outer part, anteriorly it is convex in front but concave behind. Along the outer lip of the iliac crest, there is a tubercle about 5 cm behind anterior superior iliac spine. This is known as tubercle of iliac crest. The dorsal segment has lateral slope, medial slope, and a ridge between them. Just below anterior superior iliac spine, there is a notch below which there is another elevation, and this elevation is known as anterior inferior iliac spine. At the posterior end of iliac crest, there is posterior superior iliac spine, below which there is another spine which is known as posterior inferior iliac spine, and below posterior inferior iliac spine, there is a wide notch which is known as greater sciatic notch. Along the upper border of greater sciatic notch, here, there is a preauricular sulcus. Preauricular sulcus, which you can feel along the upper margin of greater sciatic notch. It is deeper in females compared to the males. The highest point of iliac crest is just a little behind the midpoint of the iliac crest. And this highest point of iliac crest, it lies at the level of the interval between the spines of L3 and L4 vertebra. Now there are three borders and three surfaces of ilium. The anterior border starts from anterior superior iliac spine. Trace it down. There is anterior inferior iliac spine. up to the upper end of the pubis. Here the junction of ilium and pubis, which is known as iliopubic eminence. So up till here is the anterior border of ilium. This is iliopubic eminence. The posterior border begins from posterior superior iliac spine. Lower down there is posterior inferior iliac spine up to the upper part of the greater sciatic notch, below which starts the posterior border of ischium. On the inner or pelvic aspect, there is a third border which is known as medial border. This is the medial border extending from iliac crest up to iliopubic eminence. This medial border of ilium is also known as chilotic line. It is also known as chilotic line. This chilotic line has two parts, the upper sacral part related to sacrum, and this lower part is known as the pelvic part. Then there are three surfaces of ilium. On the outer aspect, there is a gluteal surface, and on the inner or pelvic aspect, there are two surfaces. In front, the concave surface is the iliac fossa or iliac surface, which is in front of medial border. Behind the medial border, this surface is known as sacropelvic surface. Now coming to the gluteal surface, there are three gluteal lines on the gluteal surface. First is the posterior gluteal line. Posterior gluteal line begins about 5 cm in front of the posterior superior iliac spine and it runs downwards. It ends just above posterior inferior iliac spine. So this is the posterior gluteal line. The second gluteal line is the anterior gluteal line, which begins about 2.5 cm in front of anterior superior iliac spine. Then it runs downwards and backwards and it ends just above the middle of the upper border of greater sciatic notch. And the third is the inferior gluteal line, which begins a little above and behind anterior inferior iliac spine. It also runs downward, backward and end near the apex of the greater sciatic notch. So here we can see posterior gluteal line, anterior gluteal line and inferior gluteal line, which divide the gluteal surface of ilium into four parts. 1, 2, 3, and the fourth part is just above acetabulum. On the inner or the pelvic part, this concave surface is the iliac fossa. And behind the medial border, this is the sacropelvic surface, which is divided again into three parts. The upper large rough part is known as iliac tuberosity. So this is iliac tuberosity. Below which there is a smooth auricular surface, which articulates with the similar auricular surface of sacrum to form sacroiliac joint. Antero-inferior to it, there is a smooth pelvic part of the sacropelvic surface. And this part forms a part of the lateral wall of true pelvis. Along the upper margin of greater sciatic notch, here we can feel the preauricular sulcus, which is deeper in the female. So this is the sacropelvic surface having three parts, iliac tuberosity in the upper part. Antero-inferior to it is the auricular surface. Antero-inferior to it is the smooth pelvic part. So that is the sacropelvic surface. This is the iliac fossa. And on the outer aspect is the gluteal surface. So these are the features of the ilium. Now coming to the main attachments. The attachment on the iliac crest. The outer lip of the iliac crest gives attachment to fascia lata in the whole extent. The area in front of tubercle gives origin to tensor fascia lata. The anterior two-third of the outer lip receives insertion of external oblique muscle of abdomen. The inner lip of the iliac crest, anterior two-third, there is origin of transversus abdominis muscle of abdomen from the anterior two-third. And deep to it, there is attachment of fascia transversalis and fascia iliaca. In the posterior one-third, there is origin of erector spinae muscle. The intermediate area gives origin to the internal oblique muscle from its anterior two-third part. Also, from the posterior one-third of the outer lip, there is origin of latissimus dorsi muscle. From the inner lip, there is origin of quadratus lumborum muscle. The dorsal slope gives origin to gluteus maximus from the lateral slope of the dorsal segment and erector spinae from the medial slope. The anterior superior iliac spine gives attachment to the lateral end of inguinal ligament. The inguinal ligament is a ligament which is attached between anterior superior iliac spine and pubic tubercle, like this. So the lateral end of inguinal ligament gives attachment, is getting attached to anterior superior iliac spine, whereas the medial end is getting attached to pubic tubercle. The anterior superior iliac spine also give origin to sartorius muscle. So there are two attachments over anterior superior iliac spine. One is inguinal ligament and other is origin of sartorius. Coming to anterior inferior iliac spine, the upper part of it gives origin to straight head of rectus femoris muscle and the lower part gives attachment to iliofemoral ligament. Coming to the posterior border, above greater shatic notch, this border gives attachment to the upper fibers of sacrotuberous ligament, whereas the upper margin of greater shatic notch, it gives origin to few fibers of piriformis muscle. The iliac fossa, upper two-third of it, gives origin to iliacus muscle. The lower part is related to iliac bursa. Coming to the gluteal surface, the area behind the posterior gluteal line gives origin to gluteus maximus muscle. The area between posterior and anterior gluteal lines gives origin to gluteus medius muscle. The area between anterior and inferior gluteal lines give origin to gluteus minimus muscle, whereas the area below inferior gluteal line gives origin to reflected head of rectus femoris muscle, just above acetabulum. So these are the attachments on the gluteal surface. The sacropelvic surface, the iliac tuberosity, which is the rough part, upper part, gives attachment mainly to ligaments, namely interosseous sacroiliac ligament, dorsal sacroiliac ligament, and superiorly is the iliolumbar ligament. The convex margin of the auricular surface gives attachment to ventral sacroiliac ligament. The ventral sacroiliac ligament also attached to the margin of preauricular sulcus, whereas the remaining part of the pelvic surface gives origin to obturator internus muscle. A small part of piriformis also arises from this smooth pelvic part of the sacropelvic surface. There is one more attachment along the outer lip of iliac crest, The area in front of tubercle of iliac crest gives origin to tensor fascia lata, which is on the outer lip of iliac crest. So this completes our general features and attachments on ilium, along with the site determination and how to hold it in anatomical position. Thank you. In the next video, we will learn the general features and attachment of pubis, followed by the general features and attachments on ischium. Thank you.